Because there will be a load of people that think this is fake anyway. I mean, yep. You know, when you saw it earlier, it almost looks fake when it's right in front of you.
Ready? And 3, 2, 1.
Hey guys, on our last episode of Make It Real, my team and I flew down to California to meet Richard Browning from Gravity Industries to try out his 1,000 horsepower jet suit. Make sure you go check it out. And if you haven't already, make sure you subscribe to Gravity's YouTube channel. If they get enough new subscribers, they might let me fly the suit at full power. Anyway, while we were there, we also got to interview Richard one-on-one and learn more about how he designed the jet suit and how it works. We also gave him a very special gift to complete the suit. This might be one of the most in-depth engineering interviews on the jet suit, so we hope you guys enjoy. Oh, and don't forget to check out our vlog channel to see a 40-minute long extended cut of...
Because there will be a lot of people that think this is fake anyway. I mean, you know, when you saw it earlier, it almost looks fake when it's right in front of you. I see it as flattery when people still say it's fake.
All right, you're doing it. You're living out every little kid's dream of flying like Iron Man. Let's start at the beginning. How did this actually like get started? Because I know you've always been interested in flying, and then you got that one jet engine, and you started playing with it. What was the step that took you to, let's buy a jet engine and strap it to my arm?
Yeah, that's a very fair question. I had a sensible job in London, just mostly sitting at a desk for about 16 years or so, but I've always had a bit of a habit, I mean, probably not dissimilar to you, of seeing an interesting challenge and just wondering, well, how feasible might it be to go and achieve that thing, whatever it might be?
Yep.
And other bits in my life, like things like I spent 6 years in the British Royal Marines Reserve as well, and in that environment, you get to learn a lot about, you know, human capability and pushing your limits and all that kind of thing. So if you marry together an excitement for horsepower and speed and flying with the, I suppose, a fascination for what human beings can achieve, you know, balance and strength and control, you think, well, this age-old passion of flying, I wonder whether you could approach it in a really different way. And to cut a long story short, morphed into this idea, let's just kind of cheat this with a bit of horsepower and then microjet engines, you realize how monstrously powerful they are.
How did you, like, buy that one jet engine?
Yeah.
In a bunch of our videos, we've had viewers be like, Where do you go and buy a jet engine? I'm like, it's online. You can literally order one online and it shows up at your door.
It was a bit of a discovery. My family background was all in aeronautics and things like that, so it didn't feel entirely alien to imagine the idea of getting hold of a jet engine. I had no idea if this would work. I didn't even know where this would take me in the end. But I justified to myself enough that just getting one of these engines and starting to hopefully demystify a lot of the assumptions, like the 120,000 RPM torque would like rip your arm off and it would flail all over the place and the heat would roast you alive. And I thought, well, let's just go and carefully try this, that actually, they're really benign. I mean, they make an awful noise, right? And you don't want to point it at your face, that's for sure. But actually—
I've got a video on that.
Yeah, I know you have, yeah. No, we've never done exactly that, but probably one of the biggest breakthroughs, just having that one single engine and demystifying all those reasons why this shouldn't work. You know, your spirit of just get your hands dirty and learn. I'd say at the point I bought probably the fourth or fifth one, because like four, you can see in the films, jumping around with four of them. With the weight I'm at, yeah, it's like I didn't come down very quick. It's like, wow, this is getting there. I just need a couple more and I'm there. But buying like engines 5 and 6, this is starting to get an amount of money that I'm going to struggle to write off if this is going to be a massive failure. Another reason why we made such quick progress is that I tried to, you know, adapt a piece of existing technology, exactly your ethos, right? Rather than custom build some $100,000 thing and then find when it comes out of the box, it doesn't work.
No point in reinventing the wheel when you can...
No, I was constantly adapting stuff. It's tricky. It's nothing...
So to give you some perspective, we ended up spending probably close to $30,000 or $40,000 just on what we did, and we weren't even anywhere close to getting that first flight. And we're like, well, we gotta spend another $50,000 on jet engines, break one, and it's just like, well,
so
now what?
That was a really big issue, right? So we went from one engine to actually doing that first wobbly flight in about 8-9 months.
Okay.
3 of those months was waiting for repaired engines to come back. We have damaged and had repaired probably 50. As in at least 50 times had them gone away and come back.
That's hundreds of thousands of dollars.
But at least the repairs cost a lot less than buying them new. We've completely written off probably 4, I would say. Money to get to the first 6-second flight would be around, $50 to $100,000, I'd say.
Yeah, so that was kind of the biggest thing that kind of slowed us down. We're just like, well, we can either pursue this and maybe fail,
Yeah.
Or we can continue focusing on growing our YouTube business and becoming sustainable so we're able to do random projects like this in the future and keep going. So that's when we had to kind of pivot away from flying like Iron Man and into more of our, some of our smaller projects, but now we're taking on bigger projects and whatnot. In your initial tests, was it just you or did you have like a few friends? I started by myself and then I've quickly grown my team and it's so much easier with a team as you can.
Oh, massively. Yeah, I mean, this started as me and then after probably a couple of months, the one major gap in my kind of skill set was some of the software coding.
Okay.
And so there was a guy near me who was a, you know, is a brilliant coder and I kind of enrolled him. We've got now a team of approaching 20 in the UK and about 10 in the US. And then there's this enormous network of people largely that just do this for the passion of it. I mean, you've met some of the guys around here, guys and girls around here.
We all became aware of this suit, April Fool's 2017, Red Bull. It was a brilliant marketing idea, like, let's release this crazy thing on April Fool's. So many people were like, it's fake.
Yeah, right. Firstly, we didn't really engineer that it was going to be 1st of April. It just kind of happened that it appeared around that
really?
Date.
Really? Okay.
And then we thought, let's just run with it anyway, because there will be a load of people that think this is fake anyway. I mean, you know, when you saw it earlier, it almost looks fake when it's right in front of you.
Yeah.
I now see it as flattery when people still say it's fake.
So when you hovered for the first time, was it similar to Iron Man 1 when Tony put on his jets?
The learning journey that you see in the film where he's kind of learning it and falling over and stuff, we went through almost entirely the same thing. And the guys behind the CGI in the film, a lot of them have reached out to us over the last year or so and actually they've noticed in what we've done a lot of similarity and it's just all credit to them for guessing and imagining what it'd be like. So it's ended up being really similar, crazily enough.
So when you landed for the first time, did you say?
Yeah, I can fly.
I'm an unusual case because when I did that first 6 second flight, I spun round and you can see me just grinning and smiling and I was mostly glad that I managed to land it without falling over. We take risk, but we calculate what's the worst that's going to happen and if it's acceptable and I can get back up physically, but also financially and reputationally, then we'll take the risk.
Our specialty is making a really cool video. So sometimes we make it look like it's really risky, but believe it or not, we do, like, we have calculated the risk, but it's like,
you can't get up,
play it up.
It's game over, right? You know, if you've broken both your legs and you run out of money and you got arrested, that's a really bad day out, but then you can't carry on,
You want to start a racing league with these. Where you want that to go?
So I did this genuinely for the pure joy of the challenge. You know, it's a small opportunity
in life. The proper way to do it.
Right, when you look at something and like, I wonder if that's possible, because if it is possible, that could be really cool. But what's next? Can we not have like 20 of those all kind of going around in a circle and crashing a bit and celebrate who's driving them and whatever? That's, for me, is the obvious place to take this from an entertainment point of view, but mostly underneath that, if you're going to drive the technology, what better way of doing it than doing a racing series? But assembling those people and then touring the world, going to particularly, you know, big rivers running through cities, because then you've got the audience ready made there, jumping off the bridges, you know, in the Thames, flying to the next bridge, up round it, flying again, you know, you're covering the risk as you fall in the water. The main reason for doing it all is to drive this STEM agenda, you know, celebration of what science and engineering maths
awesome.
Can actually achieve.
That's the reason why we do Make It Real, because it's opening that horizon of engineering is cool. Let's celebrate that.
It's critical to everything around us, right?
Yeah.
And like I say, not only inspire a next generation to dare ask what if, but also drive the revenue that goes back into the R&D to develop cool stuff like wings.
Exactly.
That's the plan.
So you've already pinned the market on flying like Iron Man. We've got your suit.
Yeah.
We've got the Flyboard Air.
Yeah.
We've got Jetman. We've got Jetpack Aviation. We've got a whole bunch of different hoverboards that are like multi-rotor setups.
Yeah.
Do you remember Inspector Gadget?
I do. Yes, I do.
Do you remember the helicopter hat?
Yeah, I do.
I want to fly like Inspector Gadget. So we're actually starting to design.
You're doing neck exercises?
It'll actually be more of a back.
Right, I was going to say.
But we're actually going to be building a personal helicopter that is compact. So we've actually got two 75 kilowatt brushless DC motors.
Wow.
With 1.5 meter carbon fiber props.
Terrifying. What, counter-rotating?
Or counter-rotating.
Ah, that's good.
So we've got a hollow shaft, and both motors are stacked on top of each other. Okay. And in total, it'll actually produce 240 kilograms of thrust.
Oh my goodness.
We're gonna have those handles come down just like Inspector Gadget. And you're like, all right, gonna backwards, gonna go forwards. So we've bought the motors, we've bought the propellers, we've bought the speed controllers.
Yeah.
So we've sunk about 20 grand into it so far.
Cool.
So hopefully you'll see me flying around a little bit.
I mean, fundamentally, if you're, you know, the reason the helicopter works so well, even though it's using a gas turbine, it's moving a big air mass relatively slowly.
Exactly.
The bigger those blades you can make while still having a compact structure, the more efficient it's going to be. So it should be way more efficient than this. But yeah, you probably got more chance of cutting your own head off than this.
There's that
issue. That's the only challenge.
All right, so we have some questions from our audience. We've probably answered them 100 times before.
Try
but
me.
Let's just go through them. Number one, how high have you flown?
About 80 feet. Over water.
How about concrete?
Probably accidentally 25 for a few seconds. Yeah, trying to make a habit.
Yeah, how fast have you gone?
We've hit 54 miles an hour, I think it is. The record that we set is down officially at 32, but we did 54 at that Bournemouth air show.
Awesome.
And to be honest, with the power, you can go way faster.
Once you get the wings going.
Yeah, it's just a respect for the
take
stability
off.
Thing.
How many suits do you have right now?
Four.
Do you have a parachute?
No, there's no point unless you can get to parachute height, and on the way up to that, you're in a danger zone.
So if someone wanted to buy one of these, are you selling them?
Yeah, we sold two. It's
wow.
it's not our core kind of business. We don't want to have loads of people flying around with these necessarily, because if you don't know what you're doing, it's not the ideal machine.
Yep.
We sold a copy of the prototype for $250,000 not long after we launched the company. And we sold the last one, kind of a smarter version of this, to a guy in the US for about $440,000.
So if anyone wanted to try this suit, can they, and how would they do that?
Yes, so we offer flight training, particularly in the UK, but we've done it elsewhere. We've done it actually here in California. We have a tether system, a platform, and then all of that system keeps you entirely safe as you start learning the balance and control. So it's training wheels for jet suits.
All right, so why don't you walk us through the suit and just, how does it actually work?
Right, so fundamentally now with the latest setup we've got, it's five jet engines, little gas turbines. You've got two on each arm,
yep.
And then you've got one around the back, and between those clusters of thrust, that's what creates that kind of tripod or pyramid of thrust. And the control is all down to really vectoring with your arms. Where do you point them? You point them down, you go up, point them out, and then you go down again, right?
Yeah.
The fuel bladders in here, they're basically like rubberized
bags,
so you try and minimize the air inside them. And then around the front, you've got this kind of waistcoat of electronics. Inside the helmet, there's a head-up display system, which takes a wireless data feed from this box. So I can see my fuel burn and flight time and engine status. So that's quite a neat system. It's pretty simple. This is actually quite an old model now. We've now got a version which is almost entirely 3D printed, and believe it or not, in polymer.
Speaking of versions, what iteration is this, and what's your iteration right now? Like,
this is probably prototype 25 of just this pair of arm assemblies. So
wow,
hard to say really.
When you get to iteration 42, I have something for you.
Oh, 42, right. What's this? Oh, you're kidding. What's...
So this is a full metal Iron Man helmet.
You're kidding. That's very cool. Oh, that's insane. Oh, no way. You're kidding. That's so cool.
Perfect. It's got a magnet ring.
Oh. That is so cool.
Tap it again. Yeah.
There we go. The guys who build all that graphics for the film are massive supporters of ours and come to every event.
Awesome.
He was here yesterday.
Yeah.
So for our race series and stuff, we're going to build all that graphics. We should just get that connected
with
you. Yeah,
yeah.
So, cool. it's quite weird having somebody do that to your face. Yeah, that's so cool.
Jarvis, you there?
That's your service, sir.
Do a weather and ATC check.
Sir, there are still terabytes of calculations needed before an actual flight is adjusted.
Jarvis, sometimes you gotta run before you can walk.
Importing preferences and calibrating virtual environment.
Do a check on control surfaces.
As you wish.
Ready? In 3, 2, 1.
I'm looking through like a tiny little spit going, there's concrete people, how high am I?
Doing the set night is going to be brilliant.
Yeah, isn't it?
As long as I can like keep a visual on, something useful.
You're going straight to Adrian, that all.
Truth is, I am Iron Man.
Big thank you to the Gravity team for letting us come down to see the suit. If you guys want to see me fly the jet suit at full power, make sure you show Gravity some love and subscribe to them on YouTube. If they get enough new subscribers, flying might be in my future. So, please subscribe. Oh, and don't forget to check out our vlog channel to see a 40-minute long extended cut of the interview with Richard Browning. Links are right here and here.
I'm looking through like a tiny little slit going, oh, there's concrete, people, how high am I?